It's a great pleasure to introduce Joseph Grozinski, a professor at the Edmund and Lili Safra Center for Brain Research and at the Department of Cognitive Science of the Hebrew University, Jerusalem. Professor Grozinski received his PhD from Brandeis University with thesis supervisors Noam Chomsky, Meryl Garrett, and Edgar Zurif. He did his postdoctoral research at the Center for Cognitive Science, MIT, under the supervision of Noam Chomsky and Meryl Garrett. And from 1985 to 2013, he joined the Hebrew University. He held various appointments in top universities, including MIT, Boston University, McGill University, and other places. His research interests include neurolinguistics, linguistic theory, psycholinguistics, aphasia, brain mapping, neuropsychology, the syntax-semantics interface, semantics and pragmatics, and the acquisition of syntax and semantics. He has been in the editorial board of several prestigious international journals, such as the Journal of Neurolinguistics, Brain and Language, Cognition, the Journal of Psycholinguistic Research, and many others. He has numerous publications in highly prestigious journals, and he has delivered over 120 invited seminars and colloquia in Asia, Europe, North and South America. His work has influenced many psycholinguists and neurolinguists and has inspired junior and senior researchers all over the world. His tree pruning hypothesis as a framework for interpreting Broca's agrammatic production and his trace deletion hypothesis as a framework for interpreting Broca's agrammatic comprehension has inspired many people. And has inspired my work in aphasia and neurolinguistics, and I would like to thank him very much for this. So it's really a great pleasure, Joseph, to have you not in Athens, but I hope in the near future in Athens, but to have you in this conference.
Thank you so much. Okay, so now I'm sharing my screen now. Thanks very much, Spiridula, for this very kind introduction, and I guess I'm sharing my screen now. It's difficult. Yeah, can everybody see this?
Yes, everything is
okay.
Fine.
Great. Okay. Before I start, let me just tell you that about something I read in Twitter about 10 minutes ago, just before it started. So there was an announcement at Stanford that, you know, there were two Stanford economists who won the Nobel Prize in Economics or the Nobel Memorial Prize in Economics yesterday. There's a small video movie from a security camera in the house of one of them. Turns out that the Nobel Committee failed to reach him at his house. I guess his phone was on silence. And the security camera in his house showed the other guy who lives around the corner walking to his house, knocking on the door to let him know that he won the Nobel Prize. So my advice to you, if you expect the Nobel Prize, keep your phone on sound during the night, at the night you expect to get the Nobel Award from the Nobel Committee. Okay, and on this happy note, it's really amusing. Go to the Stanford website and you'll see it. I somehow got it to Twitter. Okay, so I'm gonna talk about the brain bases for logic and language, and I'm just gonna give you a little bit of just snippets from work that's being done in my lab. I think the most important thing, the thing that perhaps I'm most proud of, is the potential clinical relevance of this kind of stuff, because we've developed several iPad apps that seem to work. And I'll motivate the work quite in detail and then show you a little bit, a couple of movies to indicate how this thing works. So let's start. Okay, so first, what's happening here? Okay. I'm focusing here on negation. Why negation? Well, and again, it's just an example from a broader piece of work, but the point about negation is that the frequency of words denoting negation is extremely high. These are very, very high frequency words. If you look at frequency tables of English, it's among the 30 most frequent words in the English language, probably higher because they count no and not separately. we understand something about the logic behind these. They seem to be quite akin to the logical negation symbol, which is this little thingy here, or something that looks like a tilde, depending on what notation you choose. And we also know some things about it. We know syntactic things, we know semantic things about it. And the most basic basic property of negation is that it reverses truth value. Everybody knows that. So if P is true, then not P is false and vice versa. And we can also see it in the equivalence. We can see that it behaves nicely in language too, because the sentences in one seem to be equivalent. So if the sprinters ran is true, then the sprinters didn't run is false. This is like very basic stuff, but just as a little bit of a reminder. And let me tell you a little bit about experiments that have been done. This is an experiment that was done 50 years ago, believe it or not, I think at Stanford, California, by Bill Chase and Herb Clark, who really, Herb Clark is by far the most important foundation layer in the study of semantics, the psycholinguistics of semantics. And this experiment it was a verification experiment. You had two factors. One is like above and below, some descriptions of relations and negation, as you can see here in red and green. And what you had to do, you would receive these kinds of images one at a time, and you'd have to indicate true or false. And here's what you get. What you get is a huge difference between the negated and non-negated sentences. I'm not going to talk about truth values. So a huge difference between the one without a negation and the one with a negation across the board, and a tiny difference in these relational expressions above and below. It's really a very robust effect. But you know, it might be not that surprising, because, well, after all, there's another word that's added there, and regardless of where you measure, you end up having another word in each of these sentences. It's like easy to say that this is really nothing. So what I'm going to show you is something that would indicate the two following things. First of all, we would look at negation and try to obtain negation in the absence of an extra word in a sentence. There's a little trick that I'll show you in just a second. Secondly, that there's certain kinds of predictions that the standard frequency kind of account, which I have faced 1,000 times throughout my career, that, you know, when I bring up something the structural, people say, it's just frequency. Well, it's frequency. If it's only frequency, then it should not be localized. Negation should not be localized in the brain. And also its processing should be additive in the number of negations. So, you know, if you have one negation, you get one effect of frequency. If you have two, you need to multiply it by two, and so on and so forth. So what we're going to look at is, first of all, I'll give you the trick of what we call implicit negation. It's not my own trick. It's been around for a long time. We'll look a little bit at behavioral studies. We'll look at fMRI, a little bit of fMRI work, then we look at some patients, and then we'll move on to multiple negations. I'm not going to talk about comparative constructions, unfortunately. I forgot to delete this. All right, so here's what we know about negation. We know that negation reverses logical entailments. Entailment is a major, very important tool in the life of semanticists. So you just look at two propositions, and you ask whether one entails the other. So you know that if it's true that the sprinters ran fast, then it follows that the sprinters ran. So an entailment is, you know, the statement on the left entails the statement on the right. If once this guy is true, then this guy is also true. We'll stick to this very loose definition. And we can see how. Because if this is the set of the individuals who ran fast, we know that the set of individuals who ran is a superset of that. We'll think about it from a set theoretic perspective for just one second. So it's easy to see that if it's true that you're within this set, then you must be within the other set. And likewise, when you look at the negation, it's exactly the same logic. If it's true that you're not in the bigger set, namely the purple one of people who ran, then a fortiori, you're not in the set of the people who ran fast. It's very clear. So these are ways to think about this intuition, that these are the right directions of entailment, and we can see how the entailment direction is reversed in each of these cases. Here the green entails the purple, and here the purple entails the green in the presence of negation. Okay, we can also see that once you add another negation, then these guys cancel one another. These are things that everybody knows. If it's not the case that the sprinters didn't run, then they must have run. So the sprinters ran. Okay, and you know, you can see it in truth tables. We all know that an odd number of negations cancels one another. So the third column in the first column, or the fourth column in the first column, are exactly the same in terms of the truth values that are written here in this truth table. Okay, there's a second, so this is one property, negation reverses entailments. There's a second property, which is negation licenses NPIs. I say negation makes certain odd sentences acceptable, but actually it licenses NPIs, and we can see it here. You can say, I haven't spoken to my mother in weeks, as in 4B, but it's very odd to say, I've spoken to my mother in weeks. And likewise, I fell, and he didn't lift a finger to help me, it's fine, but I fell and he lifted a finger to help me is also fine. So we have these two basic tests, the entailment test and the NPI licensing test. And now I'm gonna show you the big magic that in fact there are words in the language that contain a negation implicitly because they behave as if they contain a negation. They pass this test even though you don't have an explicit negation. I'm sure you're not gonna fall off your chairs if you think that less, if you hear from me that less contains a negation. I just have some formal tests to back up this intuition. So again, once again, if more than half of the sprinters ran fast, then it follows that more than half of the sprinters ran. Why? If this is half of the sprinters, this is more than half of the sprinters, then who ran, this is more than half of the sprinters who ran fast, and this sentence is true, then it also follows that more than half of the sprinters ran. However, if less than half of the sprinters ran, we can see it here. So this is those individuals ran who are less than half of the sprinters. So this is the intersection between those who ran and those who are sprinters, and it's below half, then it must be the case that those who ran fast are in fact even lower, the same or perhaps lower than that. So this is how this negation test, this entailment test works. And you can see that less reverses entailments, passing one of the two tests for the presence of negation that I set up in the previous slide. We can see the same kind of thing in action here with the NPI licensing. So you can say less than half of the children have spoken to their mother in weeks, that's fine. But you cannot say more than half of the children have spoken to their mother in weeks. That's quite odd. And the same thing with the other expression that I used, lifted a finger, okay? So it turns out that these kinds of contrasts between more and less are on a par with a contrast between the absence and the presence of negation. And if we use them, we might have sentences that contain the same number of words, actually the same number of syllables, and still, one of them contains some kind of an implicit negation and the other does not. And this is something that we've done. We actually use these things in processing and neuropsychological tests, as you will see in a minute. And what we've been doing is we've been presenting such pairs of sentences, like more than half of the circles are blue and less than half of the circles are blue. We've been presenting them in verification tests, like the one that you see here, and you can see that these sentences, you can construct pairs of sentences which are equivalent in terms of their meanings, okay? You can contrast such sentences, you can construct such sentences, and it gives you stimuli for a verification test, and this is what we've done. So this is an experiment that we published several years ago with Galit Agmon and Isabel Deschamps as the lead authors, students of mine, as lead authors, and Jonathan Lowenstein, a physicist working at the Hebrew University. We did the following experiment, and what we did was we had people listen to sentences like the ones that I just mentioned and watch some kind of an image, and then we had them look at the equivalent expressions in some quasi-algebraic notation like greater than and smaller than, They just saw this. These were symbolic expressions that were presented visually, and these were expressions that were presented auditorily. There used to be a headphones here, but it kind of vanished for some reason. And then they would make a judgment, as you can see here in this table. And this is the structure of one trial, which had a very fixed temporal structure. And we started recording reaction time from the beginning of the image. We separated the two, which turned out to be very, very important later. We also wanted to see whether this kind of stuff interacts with Weber's law, namely with numerical perception. So we actually varied the proportion between the number of yellows and the number of blues. We had 7 different proportions, and we could actually see Weber's law in action and see whether or not it interacts with the psycholinguistic considerations. So here's what we found. We found something that I thought was quite amazing, and we did it in several versions. It's an extremely robust effect, let me tell you. So first of all, we can see Weber's law in action, namely, as the proportion between yellow and blue approaches 1, it becomes more difficult. That's not surprising, but moreover, and this is where Weber's law gets into action, you will notice that in fact, the scale here is logarithmically compressed. So this is a logarithmic axis here. You're not looking at, the distances do not represent the actual number of blues in this case, but the natural logarithm of this number. And you can see that you obtain a fairly symmetrical curve here, if you want to fit one. We measured it, we did all kinds of calculations. I have a physicist with a lot of computational muscle, so we measured it, and in fact, it is abiding by Weber's law, by everyone's criteria. So this is one thing that you see both for more, which is the blue line, and for less, which is the red line. You can see the same thing also for the greater than and lesser than. The same effect is an effect that you see. But what you see that's quite amazing is that there's a big difference between more and less across all numerosities, whatever proportion that you have, and there's nothing of that kind that you get when you do those inequality signs. It's an extremely selective effect. And if you collapse all the proportions together, you can actually see the bar graph that you see in the picture at the bottom right. So the mean of all the stimuli with more is greater, with less is greater than the mean of all the stimuli with more. But this is not the case for those arithmetical expressions. And there's a very robust interaction that you can see here. I just want to note that the effect of the difference between less and more is really robust. So with very few exceptions, you look here at individual subjects and you see the less and the more for each of them, and very few of them do not give you a big difference between less and more. So less is more costly. We'll get to this individual difference issue in just a second. So now we moved. The next thing we did was we moved and we tested it in fMRI. This is work that's done together with the same authors, but with my colleagues. And in fact, I'm also part of this center that's called Forschungszentrum Jülich, which is a big research center in Germany. And my great colleagues, probably the best anatomists on earth, Katrin Amunds and her team, in this case, it's Peter Pieperhoff and Francesca Janili. We teamed up and we did this, we studied this thing in fMRI. And what we got, amazingly, in one brain area, which is this little blob that you see here, this little red blob that you see on the top left, we got the very same effect. You can see that the bar graph that you get here on the left is very much like the bar graph for the reaction times that you get on the right. It's very much the same. And in fact, what we did was, not only did we find a single cluster of activation in the brain, and we'll talk about its anatomy in just a second, but also we looked at correlations between the individual reaction time functions and individual activation functions, and you get a very good correlation. So you can think about it, if you're a fast negator, so the cost of negation for you is low, the activation in this area is also low. If you're a slow negator, so the cost of negation for you is high, then the activation for you here is also high. I think it's quite amazing that negation you know, the reaction time function negation effect is in fact a good predictor of activation. It's very, very nice. It convinces you that it's something real and not something marginal. And, you know, we have all kinds of controls where you don't get it and so on and so forth. So then, because we're lucky to have a team of anatomists, we moved on to actually characterize the fine histology of this, namely the Brodmann-like region and the relationship between that region that is here and what we found in the functional in the functional test. And in fact, it's probably the first time ever that a functional test motivated, I think it is the first time that the functional result motivated the anatomical study. And what we got is a fantastic match between the FMRI cluster, which is the one in purple here, and the anatomical cluster. This is an area that is now called the insula discranial area 7, or ID7, if you will. And what's remarkable about it is if you look at the difference at whether or not there is any overlap between it and the standard areas for language activation, which is like Brodmann's area 44 and 45, that I'm sure all of you have heard about, there's no overlap. So you might, and here you can see actually a quick little movie that shows you that. So you can see this is like a 3D reconstruction. And one thing you can see here is that here you can actually see really the absence of overlap between these things. It's very, very nice. And you can see it all along. And one way to think about it is that in fact, because this is something having to do with logical operations, is perhaps this is where language stops and logical thought begins, because it's very clear that you output linguistic representations, organize them in some kind of a logical format, and move them on to the world of reasoning and decisions, which you find in prefrontal cortex. It's not that surprising to find it there, but it's very comforting that you actually have solid evidence for this kind of stuff. So this was chapter number one, namely the neuroanatomy, the fine neuroanatomy of well-motivated studies of negation. And you can actually see that you can do it with linguistic tools and you can study the brain loci of it. And this is actually possible and quite precise. Sorry for praising my own work, but I kind of, for once, I think it's not so bad. So one question that we ask next is, what happens if we have more than one negation? Okay, so we know that there's a difference between an even and odd number of negations. So an even number of negations preserves truth value, whereas an odd number changes the direction of inferences or the direction of implication or whatever. So we asked whether the cost of negation accumulates, or do negation pairs cancel one another? And you can think about it in two possible ways. One way is that negation cost is cumulative. It grows with the number of negation operators. You can also think about it as something that has to do with monotonicity, for those of you who studied semantics a little bit, where perhaps RT grows only when the number of negations is odd. So you always move pairs if they're, you know, you remove pairs, and this is how you calculate it. And we did this kind of study. The leaders of the study, the leader was Ian Tan, a graduate student in my lab, and Andreas Haida and Asaf Brown joined her in this. And what we had is we had sentences like more than half of the circles are blue and less than half, but we also added a negation, not more than half of the circles are blue and not less than half of the circles are blue. And there are two possible processing functions. One of them in which negation is cumulative. So you know, you move from more to not more and it costs you something. It costs the same as when you move from more to less, and then not less is the costliest. But there's another possibility, which is you move from more to not more and it costs you something. You move from more to less and it costs you something. But when you move from more to not less, it costs you nothing because two negations cancel one another. These are the two possibilities, and we tested it in the same method. So what did we get? We had 25 subjects. What we got is moving from more to not more is costly. Moving from more to less is costly, but it costs less. And finally, moving, that's the most surprising thing, is moving from less to not less cost you very little, but still it costs you quite a lot relative to more. So you did not get the picture that you wanted. Make no mistake about it. I'm not claiming that what we got is what we hoped to get. We had hoped to get. But it's sufficiently intriguing to think about what this is about. Unfortunately, I'm not going to dwell much on it. I'm just going to say that I think that the reason why we didn't get it has to do with implicature. So there are all kinds of implicatures associated. It's a different talk, and I'm not going to get into it. But I just want you, at least to impress you with the fact that you do have highly structured data here, something that's worth exploring. It's not some accidental something, but it's actually worth exploring. And if you need some more, let me tell you that we did something else. What we did was we had the same experiment, Ian did it, the same experiment, except we positioned the negation in a different way. So instead of having not more than half of the circles of blue and not less than half the circles of blue, what we did was we put the negation, we made the negation sentential. It did not just negate the quantificational phrase, but it was a sentential negation. So it's not the case that more than half of the circles are blue, and it's not the case that less than half the circles are blue. We positioned it here. And I just want you to see what we got. What we got was that in the case of, that the only case in which this, you can see in these graphs, the only instance in which the less and more behave pretty much the same, the only instance was not more and not less. In every other instance, whether or not it had sentential negation, as in this case, or it did not have a sentential negation, there was a big difference in reaction times between more and less. So more was cheaper than less. Here you can see more is cheaper than less, even though there is a negation, but sentential one. It's only in this instance that you get hardly any difference. In fact, it's to some extent reversed. You get an interaction and all that. We only tested 22 subjects. We cannot test any more right now because of COVID, but I'm sure that we'll have more. It looks pretty robust. You can see the dispersion of the actual individual subject data. It's not particularly broad, the dispersion. So it actually looks like it's even more structured than we had anticipated. Before I stop, I want to move to the clinical applications. I just want to mention two things. Frequency cannot be an account here. We tested the hypothesis that it has to do with selective learning and that it comes from errors, and all these are false. If you want, I can expand on it during the question period, but I want to move to the clinical stuff. And here's the first clinical result. It's almost 10 years old. It came out of an experiment that I ran in Buenos Aires almost a decade ago with Virginia Hychenko and Maria Elisa Sanchez from the University of Buenos Aires. And I want you to look at this patient where this is the first patient we tested. She was in aphasic, something that resembled the Broca's aphasia. I mean, the lesion was pretty big. You will see it in a second. But I want you to see what she did in these two cases.
Muchos de los círculos son celestes. Sí.
Okay, so it's many here, and she was very fast in saying sí. Look what she does with pocos.
Pocos de los círculos son azules.
Manos. Ask
pocos
for more.
De los círculos son azules.
More.
Pocos de los círculos son azules.
You can see it's the same kind of picture. It's the same kind of situation. I think she actually answered correctly in the end, but it took her a very, very long time. And we're quite impressed by this huge, huge difference. And we started exploring it. The lesion of this patient, by the way, is here. It's a very bad CT. This is the best we could get at the time. We're actually studying dozens of patients like this right now in a much better way, which you will see in just a second. We published it in the Handbook of Negation. And the important thing here, just for you to see, not the performance of the patients on the quantifiers, which were kind of varied, but the fact that all these patients, with one exception, the numbers are small, but with one exception, everyone performed very well when it came to these inequality signs. I thought it was quite remarkable. I want you to see the iPad app that we've developed, and this is something in Hebrew, but there's a translation, don't worry. So here is a patient in a hospital here, acute aphasia, and look what this patient does.
בתמונה יש יותר ריבועים צהובים מריבועים כחולים.
Very fast.
בתמונה יש פחות ריבועים כחולים מריבועים צהובים.
Okay, he got it right this time. So we have developed this, which we're testing. It's a fairly big, large project involving the neurologist in Shaare Tzedek Hospital in Jerusalem and people from the image processing group at the Hebrew University with Leo Yoskovich, an image processing guy. And what we do is we test many patients in the acute stage. The point is to have this app, it's sitting in the hospital. We don't have to be there. It measures very precisely. There's a research assistant that does many things in the hospital, and among others, it does that. She does that. And then we get their scans, we segment them, and the idea is to get a large-scale mapping using this app, which tests, you know, like a large number of constructions and syntax and also semantic contrast like this. Finally, we're using this stuff in the operating room. So we have this fantastic collaboration with Marcel Kamp, Marion Rapp, and the chief of onconeurosurgery in the clinic, Uniklinik in Düsseldorf, Michael Zabel. It's a fantastic collaboration where we test patients intraoperatively. You can see me here standing in front of a patient with the same app, except it's a modified app. The idea is you take tumor patients, which you have to remove the tumor for, and you use the patient as a navigational aid. What you do, I'm sure all of you know, it's been around since Penfield, you do this like direct electrical stimulation of cortex. We decide on the positions that we test beforehand. We test the patient while they're stimulating. Here you can see Marion, who's the surgeon here, sitting and operating. This is where the patient is, and we're on the other side looking at her. And I'll show you how this goes, just so that you can see. This is in German, but you can see it's basically the same thing with more and with less. I'm now behind the shoulder of Marion's. You will see her stimulating here. This is the iPad. Andreas Haida, my postdoc, is standing there and operating it. He's going to time the stimulation. He's going to give the instructions to the neurosurgeon, and the patient will respond because she's awake now, even though her brain is actually exposed.
Yes.
Auf dem Bild sind weniger rote als blaue Punkte.
Yes.
Auf dem Bild sind weniger gelbe als blaue Quadrate.
So this is how we do this.
Papierkorb. Yes.
This is how we do this, and what we end up doing is mapping. There's a video camera on top, and we can map precisely. This is the work of Marcel Kamp. It's very difficult. It's mapped precisely onto some template that looks at the brain. It's not easy to do this. It's really, really difficult. When you look at the brain live, it doesn't look like all these simulations, but he does it. And then we end up mapping these points on the histological maps in Jülich. This is Petr Pieperhoff and Katrin Amunds. This is what they do. And the hope is to keep accumulating a lot of data. It's very difficult to do this. And now, of course, it's almost stopped because I'm not allowed to go into Germany unless I sit in quarantine for 2 weeks, which I'm not going to do very soon. So that's life. Anyway. Just on some kind of a more optimistic note, this is the same patient. I'm testing her a couple of days later, and you can see she's doing quite well. So this is less. This is with less. And you can see she was quite alert. She was actually a wonderful, wonderful patient. And as far as I know, she's back to work and everything is good. All right. So we can see that negations gives you a highly structured processing signature, both explicit and implicit. And once you multiply negations, you get an effect. You can see that the position of effect matters. And you also, I hope you got at least a glimpse of how you can take all these like heavy theoretical stuff and make it work for you in the clinic. And this is what I hope will happen. I should thank, before I stop, I should thank all these funding institutions that have funded this work, and also the collaborators in Quebec at the Hebrew University, in Jülich, in Düsseldorf, Buenos Aires. There's probably others that I forgot, but this is basically it, and I thank you very much. That's it. I'm done.
Thank you. I'm not sure whether Athena will coordinate the discussion, the questions. Athena?
Okay, thank you very much. We can start with Michael, Mikhail, Paradovsky, and please all the others, you can raise hands in the participants tab because they disappear at the users.
Toda Rabba Yosef, really fascinating stuff. I was wondering, I may have missed it when you discussed the sentential negation, but would you say that the results of your experiments and the location of the negation can tell us something about the models of language processing, whether, for instance, it's more the linear distance that matters, for instance, between negation and quantifiers, or whether it's more the structure, grammatical structure of the utterances that matters, for instance, in the semblance of cyclicity principles or subjacency, where in generative syntax, it's believed that some operations cannot take place across certain boundaries or phrases?
Well, I mean, this is a great question, namely, what distinguishes the cases in which you get a difference between implicit negation and no, between more and less, and those in which it gets canceled in the presence of a negation. This is exactly Ian Tan's dissertation. And in fact, we had a long discussion of it with the rest of her doctoral committee, which includes people who are which are experts bigger than me on negation, Immanuel Shemlai and Bernhard Schwartz. And these are great semanticists. I'm just pointing this out. But the question is probably not syntactic at all. It's difficult to imagine how it would be syntactic, because you may be right in that the position of negation matters, but the question is, what does it matter to? Because negation, both in Hebrew and in English, is very close to the VP. But you know that in etlf somehow it's way higher, because it's got to negate the whole proposition. So, and there's like no subjacency limitations or anything of that kind that restrict you here. This doesn't seem to be the case. It is quite possible, however, that when you package the quantificational phrase together with the negation in a case like not less than, the processing effects are manifest immediately. Now, let me tell you that there are all kinds of puzzles there, because one thing that you would expect is that if you package the whole thing immediately, then not less than half should be an upward entailing expression. So if it's an upward entailing expression, it should not license an NPI lower or downstream. And actually it does. So you can say something like not less than half of the student lifted the finger to help me. This is actually, it's much more grammatical than more than half of the students lifted the finger to help me. So there are all kinds of oddities here that in fact no one has studied. The closest to study it is Vincent Omer, a French linguist who's currently at UMass Amherst. He's the closest to study something like that, but not close enough, okay? So he has actually looked at negations together with expressions like possible and impossible. So he studied what happens when you say it's not possible that he bought any books, okay? Which is grammatical. And apparently he says that when you say it's not impossible that he bought any books, I don't know, William is the only native English speaker that I see here. Maybe you have an opinion, but he claims that it's ungrammatical, but in French, I'm sorry, maybe there's a speaker of French here, but I don't know. I mean, the thing is, there's no study that I'm personally aware of that has in fact looked at the puzzles having to do with negation on the quantifier itself and its monotonicity. But one thing I can say almost for sure, it doesn't seem to be a syntactic issue, but more of a semantic one. And again, Ian Tan will hopefully come up with an interesting solution soon.
Right, thank you.
Thank you. William, please.
Yes, fascinating work, Yossi. I think this maybe is this, well, I've heard about a lot of it before, but each time I hear about it, I discover new things and think of new things. I'm especially interested this time about the kind of functional localization in this ID7 area, which I guess must be in the insula. So you showed us a sort of, so I guess it's cortical and sort of more effectively deeper than Broca's area and so on. One thing I'm very curious about though is its relationship with language areas. So you emphasized that you get different results when you look at a symbolic representation of the question, fewer blue or yellow circles, whatever, versus linguistic. If I understood correctly, it's actually specifically the linguistic presentation that with negation that causes increased activity in this insular area. So I gather it's not the symbolic thing doesn't do it. So I'm wondering just what is this area doing?
Okay, it's a fantastic question, okay. And again, you have to admit that it's not the first time you've heard this. But anyway, it's a great question. And the thing is this, first of all, let me tell you in 1 minute how this effect is obtained, because it's difficult to obtain. We're talking about the functional stuff. The effect that you look, do you see the presentation screen?
Mm-hmm.
Can you see it? Okay. So I'll go back one slide. What the effect here is fished out as the interaction effect. So this is what we call the net negation effect. What you want is to neutralize all kinds of effects of directionality and directionality of reading and things of that kind. Mm-hmm. And the trick for you to note, because you see the simple effect between less and more is too robust, and it you get all kinds of activations. You must clean it out. And the way to clean or clean up, whatever preposition you might want to use, and the way to clean it is by really looking at the interaction effect. If you go to this paper, you get the reasoning, but the thing is, you have to look at the interaction effect, and this is how you get it to be clean. So it's not exactly the way you phrased it, but it's close enough. It's close enough, okay? So this is how you get this effect. You say, I want to get exactly the effect of negation and nothing else, nothing about the linear relationship between the constituents you heard and so on and so forth. This is how you get it. And as I pointed out, you also get it in the reaction times and you get this correlation. So first of all, this is the functional effect. Now, anatomically, you're absolutely right. This is the anterior part of the left insula, as you could see it before. And now the question is, what does it do? And it's a fine question. And I'll answer what people say that it does and why what they say is different. It is different from what we do. So there's a guy, an anatomist, who I think is now retired by the name of Bud Craig at the University of Minnesota, who really dedicated his career to the study of the insula, of the anterior insula. And if you look up in this paper that we published, you will see a reference to a review paper of his from 2009 or something like this. It's a great review paper in one of those ticks or tins or one of those things, I forget which ones. It's a great review paper. I read a little bit beyond this review, but one thing that you would see, there's this thing that I always forget the word, but there's something about perception of self that's attributed to the anterior part of the insula. Now, I don't know how, what is it called?
Not proprioception.
Not that one, but close enough.
Okay.
But no, you're exactly in the right direction. No, proprioception is knowing where your organs are. This is something about the self, and it's very close to proprios. It's somethingception, and I always forget this word. You're just in the right direction. So what he claims is that the anterior insula is in charge of that. Here's the issue. If you look at every single study of this stuff, you notice two things that distinguish it from ours. One, they all activate the left and right insula equally. Two, they always go anteriorly to the anterior cingulate. Mm-hmm. So if you look at where the signal goes, it goes to the anterior cingulate. In our case, it only activates the left insula. I mean, it activates when you start lowering thresholds, you see the right insula, but it takes you quite a while. And secondly, when you look at where the signal goes, when you start lowering the thresholds, it goes to area 44 in exactly the opposite direction. So this is actually an indication that you're looking at something that's quite distinct from this stuff that's quite mysterious. This is all I can say in setting this stuff apart from other stuff. Okay, because do you think I know what this not proprio but somethingception is? It's too soft. It's too soft for me to even understand. Okay. But I have to point out to a problem, and it's a little bit of a puzzle that arises. Not a terrible problem, but something that needs to be recognized. If you go to the anatomy, and believe me, Catherine and her team, they are as solid as I don't know, the Rock of Gibraltar, if it's even solid anymore. One thing that we looked at, and you can see it in the paper, is compared the volumes of the right and left insulas in all the brains that we have. There are 10 brains, okay? And there's no significant difference between the left and the right insula. So anatomically speaking, in terms of volume. So this is something to grapple with, namely, if there's no difference, why don't you get a difference why do you get a difference in activation? And the answer is, there are many puzzles in life, and here's one I cannot answer right now. No, but it's important to recognize,
the left-right thing, though, seems language connected, probably, right?
Yes, but in this particular part, in this particular suborgan, namely ID7, there is no left-right difference in volume. At least we have tools to, yes.
Yeah.
At least we have tools to study. That's already a beginning.
Right.
Fascinating.
And thank you very much, Jesse.
Thank you. I was hoping to see you in Athens, but didn't happen.
Hey, Professor Botinis is next.
Well, Joseph, I'm very happy I'm here listening to you.
I'm happy you're happy.
I'm really happy. You're here. And as we said before, we should be in Athens in a coffee place and further discussions under the tree, like Socrates.
I was telling my friends that I'm eating souvlaki on Zoom.
Of course. Okay. Well, it's very fascinating indeed. But I would say something like this. Negation is cultural, not linguistic. Okay, now it's chicken and egg. Because we take the cultures we know more, or I know more, the Swedes, they never say no. You never know what they mean also. The Germans, they start with no. I have many German friends. No, we cannot do this. The Greeks, they say, not all, I mean some, okay? And not all Germans say no right away. The Greeks say, especially in the academic world, yes, something like this, and then it's no. Are they going to cheat the brain? Or depends
on... Wait. Let as somebody who says no all the time, okay, let me say no to you. So as somebody who says no all the time, let me say no to you, okay? Because the thing is this, you're absolutely right that there are cultural differences that manifest in maybe the frequency of no, maybe the context of no, maybe the reliability of no, things of that kind. I couldn't agree more, you know. I say no 50 times a day, especially when my daughter is around. But the thing is, it has nothing to do with how no or not, in this case, is embedded in the sentential context. And I don't think that there would be a single Swede or a single Greek who would challenge the entailment patterns that I noted earlier on. So if it's true that the sprinters ran, then it is false that the sprinters did not run. And this is every Greek speaker would agree on. So, you know, there are lots of cultural effects, but these cultural effects have to be put aside in the context of tasks that we use. And in fact, it is our mission to be very careful and make sure that these kinds of cultural factors that no doubt exist, no doubt you're right, but what we have to do is always to make sure that these cultural factors do not enter into our experiments.
Well, thank you. I'll say one word more, because Please. It's another aspect. With some Greeks, if you say yes, of course, and then you finish with no, it's all right. But if you say no, they get mad. He is against me. It's war.
We try again.
The one is you are nice. The other is you are awful. You break my nerves. In other culture, in the German within parentheses or within quotation marks, oh, this is a strange person. It's all right. It's perfect. They don't break my nerves. They are forward. They are straightforward. So it's going around and around. And my questions, I come back to the original. How is the brain reacting? I mean, does the brain know all these tricks that languages and cultures do? How do
is this the, is a very this question is too difficult for me. I'm serious. It's too difficult. But you know, there no doubt are cultural differences, and one of our tasks is to get around these and make sure that they don't enter into our experimental paradigms. This is why we need to run tightly controlled experiments. Sometimes we succeed and sometimes we fail, but at least we try.
Thank you very much, Dean.
Thank you
for being with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joseph. Always inspiring. Okay.
Thank you.
I hope we'll get in touch soon again.
I hope we're not far, so we'll get in one of these directions once it's possible.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.